broken, as it needs to be reformed.
Joining me now to talk about this, CNN legal and national security analyst Asha Rangappa. She's also a former special agent at the FBI. And also with us, CNN national security analyst Samantha Vinograd. Asha, one of the main concerns, and you heard it there from Dan Coats, with so many people at the White House still operating on these temporary clearances, they're not supposed to be privy to the most sensitive of classified information until they get their permanent clearance. Do you think that some people may have access to sensitive information they should not?
I'm sure they do. Interim clearances are given when you're still waiting for a background check to be completed. But it sounds like in this case, the FBI has completed its checks and has provided the relevant derogatory information, which means anything that's a red flag, to the White House a long time ago. Brianna, we had a saying in the FBI that character is what you do when you think no one is looking. And the whole point of the background check process is to find things that might affect someone's integrity or judgment or trustworthiness. And what we see now is that there are a lot of people who apparently have some things holding up their clearances, and the White House isn't really on top of it or taking it seriously or trying to figure out what's going on. And I think that's actually a big problem because they're not limiting the information that they have access to.
Sam, you handled a lot of classified information when you were on the National Security Council under the Obama administration. Are there generally safeguards in place to stop people who only have a temporary clearance, maybe supposed to be when they first start working there, from accessing ultra-sensified classified information?
Well, typically, the short answer is yes. And I feel the need to say this just because the White House is putting out so much misinformation on this. This is not normal. Interim clearances, as Asha pointed out, are for a short period of time while an investigation concludes. They're not supposed to be for 13 months. And when you have an interim clearance, typically it goes up to the secret level, not to the top secret level or compartmentalized level, like we know Jared Kushner, for example, has had. And so I think that there's a major counterintelligence risk. And the fact of the matter is that no one disagrees that Rob Porter, Jared Kushner, and others have red flags. The fact of the matter is that the investigation was concluded. We know this from testimony yesterday. And the White House chose to knowingly disregard the advice of the intelligence community yet again. I worked for two presidents. I had clearances under two presidents. I have never heard of the White House saying to the intelligence community, okay, we don't take your advice. We don't believe you when you say this person is a counterintelligence risk. And I think it follows a pattern, frankly, of the White House listening to the intelligence community when it fits their political or personal interests, like with the Nunes memo, and disregarding the intelligence community's advice when it comes to topics they're uncomfortable with, like the Russia investigation, or in this case, the counterintelligence risk posed by Rob Porter.
I do want to ask about Russian meddling in the election. It was such a big topic yesterday on the on Capitol Hill. And Sam, you point out in your column on CNN.com that the DNI Coats indicated there's no single agency in charge of coordinating efforts when it comes to looking at Russian meddling in the election, trying to stop it from happening again. Why is that such a significant lapse?
Well, it's just really disappointing because there is a body, the National Security Council, and I served on it for 4 years, whose responsibility and mission it is to coordinate interagency policy on a range of issues. What that means is there are several agencies, the FBI, Homeland Security, CIA, State Department, that provide inputs to the policymaking process, whether it be intelligence or diplomatic expertise. Mm-hmm. The National Security Council under H.R. McMaster should be taking those inputs and making policy recommendations to the president, at which point the president weighs in on those options and makes the decision. We have reporting. There hasn't been a cabinet-level meeting on Russia yet. That's really dangerous.
And Asha, really quickly, we have 30 seconds, but I know there's legal constraints that concern you here.
Yes, these agencies can, as Sam said, collect intelligence, engage in counterintelligence. But in order to implement policy, that has to come from the top. By law, the president is the one who has to authorize any kind of proactive measures to counter Russia's election interference efforts.
All right. Asha Rangappa and Sam Vinograd, thank you so much to both of you. Any minute now, President Trump will be